Good morning and welcome to Reigate Park Church, from wherever you are joining us from. Our reflection is being led by our minister, the Reverend George Watt. And after the service, we invite you to Zoom coffee. The joining instructions will be at the end of the service on the screen. Our call to worship. We have come together in the presence of the Lord. So let us quieten our hearts and minds. Put aside our concerns and distractions. Let us open ourselves to listen for God's voice. For the word God has for his people. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that you know us and can see our potential, for you know who we are created to be. We thank you for all the people you have placed in our lives, parents, teachers, guardians, friends, whoever they may be, people who have made a real difference. We thank you for the blessings of relationships, but most of all for our relationship with you. Help us to bless others in your name. Thank you, Lord, that when we are hurt, confused, or unsure about something or someone, we can come to you. Thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit's wisdom and guidance. Lord, our hearts are lifted by your presence in our lives. All glory to you with thanks and praise. Lord, we come before you to say sorry. Sorry for all the times we've let you, ourselves, and others down. Sometimes, Lord, we're so busy talking and doing that we fail to hear you. We miss the still small voice saying, "Stop, listen." Lord, we're sorry for being too busy to hear you. You speak in so many different ways, Lord, one being through other people, but very often we take no notice and continue in our own way. Help us to tune in to your voice. Lord, as you use others to speak to us, so you use us to draw people to you. But speaking doesn't always require words. People see our lives, our attitudes and character. Lord, we're sorry for the times we've let you down in these areas, when we pressurise others to conform to our ideas, or fail to listen and give others the space to draw closer to you. Lord, as we spend these few moments in personal reflection, we ask you to speak to us. Show us anything for which we need to say sorry and change our ways. Lord, we lift our confessions to you in your precious name. Father God, we thank you that we don't have to earn your forgiveness. It's not based on how worthy we are. We are forgiven through Christ Jesus. It is by grace that our sins are forgiven. And now we gather all these prayers together in the prayer that Jesus taught us as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Thank you. Reading from John chapter 1, verses 43 to 51 from the New International Version. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote. Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree, before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You will see greater things than that." He then added, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man."
It's not often that we hear or perhaps pay much attention to the reading we heard this morning from John's Gospel. We're probably more familiar with an earlier passage where Peter and Andrew are called to be disciples of Jesus. So here we're being introduced to Philip and to Nathanael, two of the more obscure disciples. Philip, like Andrew, has a Greek name and hailed from the same village. So no doubt they grew up together. Of course, having Greek names didn't mean that they were Greek. George is believed to have Greek origins, but I'm not Greek, nor am I English as my name might sound. And yet their names perhaps prepared them for their ministry, opening the doors to share the good news in a much more cosmopolitan sphere, and demonstrating that Jesus came not just for the Jew, but for the Gentile as well. Jesus was in the process of gathering together what looked like a motley crew, but he knew that their diversity would ensure that the gospel would spread and the kingdom would grow. Over the last year, there have been big challenges about diversity. And that's been true for us also in the church and continues to be the case. When I become moderator of Thames North Synod, it will mean that there will be no black moderators when my predecessor retires, and there will be a predominance of males. We sometimes joke about being pale, male and stale. However, I will be the only Scottish moderator. I kind of jest about that too, but in reality, there are many members of the URC who are Scottish. We need to make a conscious effort to ensure our diversity at all levels. I hope as a church that we will welcome anyone who does not necessarily fit our mould and encourage them to play a full part in the life of our church. Just as Andrew introduced Peter to Jesus, so Philip introduces Nathanael to Jesus. This is an important and valuable role that we can all play, introducing others to Jesus, be they our friends, neighbours, or family. Now we're struck immediately by Nathanael's bluntness. "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" I wonder if there's anyone in the background going, "Shh, Nathanael, you can't say that." He appears not to have received the memo about inclusivity and diversity. Nathanael came from Cana, a village not far from Nazareth, and there may have been a bit of competition between the two. Growing up in the north of Scotland, there were two villages close to each other, and there could at times be a bit of rivalry. In my village, we never dared say about our neighbouring village, "Can anything good come from there?" After all, they produced the first Prime Minister of Canada. And that would probably surprise anyone visiting Reigate today, that what appears like a sleepy village comprising mainly of crofts should be the birthplace of a world leader. It should remind us that we shouldn't make sweeping judgments, nor should we underestimate what God can do and who God might call. I know of two people who left school with just a handful of O-levels between them. One gained a degree at Oxford, and the other has a doctorate as part of their journey to become ministers of the United Reformed Church. But Nathaniel's reaction might not simply have been because he had contempt for everything about Nazareth. We read later that he had been sitting under a fig tree. That was sometimes the place rabbis sat to teach. So Nathaniel might have been sitting there being taught by a rabbi. And then Jesus describes him as an Israelite without deceit. The picture that we have of this Nathaniel is of someone who was devoutly religious and would have known his scriptures. Nazareth did not figure in his reading of those scriptures, and therefore how on earth could it figure in God's plans? Now, if Jesus was from Bethlehem, that would be a different story. Nathaniel knew something, but he definitely didn't know everything. He probably wouldn't have known about Jesus' roots. Philip says to him, "Come and see." And that word for see means understand. In other words, Philip says, leave behind your assumptions and prejudices and see the new thing that God is doing, not in the way that any of us would expect. It says much about Nathaniel's character that he went to see whether there was any truth in what was being told. It's very easy for us to think we've got it all sussed, and we miss seeing and hearing what God is doing. Half a story is no story at all. And sometimes we have to be humble enough to acknowledge that we don't always fully understand. We need to go and see. Sadly, we have seen in the States that there have been those who have been taking them in by stories that they have been fed and concluded that everything is fake news. But before we simply stand in judgment, we need to take a long, hard look at ourselves. And if we do, we'll see there have been times when we have been taken in and not opened our minds to see a different angle, and above all else, to see how God is working in different places and in different ways, using a variety of people. Nathaniel is taken aback when Jesus addresses him. "How do you know me?" he asks. Nathaniel could have recalled the verse from the prophet Isaiah, "But now this is what the Lord says, he who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine." And so he came to realize that Jesus did know him in a way that he neither expected nor had previously understood. And then the tables are turned. Nathanael calls Jesus by his name, the Son of God, King of Israel. The one who thought that he knew it all had learnt something new. And that wasn't the end of it. Jesus promised that he would see greater things. Remember that seeing is about understanding, so he would understand even more. To slightly adapt Al Johnson's phrase, "You ain't seen nothing yet." As we follow Jesus, God would have more to reveal to us as he did to Nathanael. As we walk the way, we learn and understand more. Sometimes I think I know a lot about computers and software, but then when I see experts at work, I suddenly realise that I don't know very much at all. And as I watch, I learn. I wish I knew all that I do now years ago. And I know there's many things I could do with learning now. So in our faith journey, we're always learning and we have more to learn. Following Christ, using the imagery from Jacob of angels ascending and descending and used by Jesus himself, shows us that the bridge between the divine and the human has been built so that we can see, we can understand, we can follow. And that means it's worth leaving behind our assumptions, our prejudices, our ignorance, and learn from the Master.
To our prayers of intercession, let us pray. As we have thought this morning about the call of Philip and Nathanael, we think of all those throughout history that you have called and have responded to your challenge and follow you. Today we thank you for those people who have heard your call and in faith followed you. For Abraham, Moses, Joshua, Samuel and the prophets. For John the Baptist preparing the way of Christ. The 12 disciples called to leave the security of their livelihoods to follow Jesus. The Apostle Paul called to preach the gospel to all nations. Help us to hear your call and in faith to respond. We thank you for these and all in subsequent generations who have heard your voice and responded in faith, offering to you their service, undaunted by the cost. We thank you for those we have known whose discipleship has been an inspiration to us, all those who offer an example of what it means to live and walk in faith. Help us to hear your call and in faith to respond. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his perfect revelation of you, his total love, his supreme sacrifice. Help us to hear your call and in faith to respond. Help us to learn from the example of those who have gone before us and to respond as faithfully, as willingly, and as courageously as they did. Give us ears to hear whenever you call, and faith to follow wherever you lead. Take us and use us through the power of your Holy Spirit, so that your will be done and your kingdom come through our lives. Help us to hear your call and in faith to respond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining us this morning. For those of you who are watching this live, there will be the opportunity to share fellowship over coffee after the service. Details of joining Zoom will appear on the screen. Now, prayer to end. Lord, what we have learnt this day, help us to remember. Teach us to recognise your voice. Teach us how to see you in our lives and in the lives of others, and help us to invite others to meet you through our words and our actions. And now may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be amongst us and remain with us now and forevermore. Amen.